I'm Jason Klom, and this is the Comedy on Vinyl podcast. The year is 2004. The album is Feeling Kinda Patton. The artist is Patton Oswalt, and my guest is Christian Bruhn. Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you for having me.
So, I don't know that this counts for anything or matters. You're my second Canadian in several weeks.
Oh, wow.
It's very exciting. I don't get a lot of Canadians on the show.
That's shocking, because there are thousands upon thousands of Canadians in this town.
There's so many.
This is like one of the largest Canadian cities in the world.
Is it a Canadian diaspora? Is that what we officially get to call it?
Okay. Yeah, big time.
I don't know what that has to do with anything, but you're in good company. It's you and Tommy Chong. So,
oh, great. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, there you go. He's a legend.
So this, again, I'm glad that you remember this came out in 2004. Mm-hmm. Why did you, not the vinyl. I think they released the vinyl in 2008 or 9 or 10, mm-hmm. something. I'm horrible.
I'm horrible because I haven't listened to it on vinyl.
It's really okay.
Okay, good.
It's fine. Now, why did you pick this album?
I love Patton. I think he's one of the stand-ups in my life that I've connected to the most because he's just a brilliant, smart, normal dude. I mean, a lot of stand-up comedians are. I mean, mm-hmm. you got to be smart to do stand-up. You got to be sharp. But there was something about this album and a lot of his work that I connected to, and I think that's just because I think he's felt like a misfit and an outcast in his life, and I think I connect to that a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
And he's someone who I dream of being as smart as one day. I mean, he's just so sharp, he's so well read, he's so educated, and he doesn't dumb things down for his audience.
Sure.
He is completely himself up there. In this wonderful, humble, self-deprecating way.
Mm-hmm.
But he's just, you know, he's just doing his thing. He's not trying to. And that's, I think, what makes the most successful comedian is, or even actor, is someone who just is purely themselves because they know that that's what they've got going for them better than anybody else. I mean, that's kind of the key to our business, I think.
Sure.
But he's just a shining example of that. I think the comedians that I've always connected to over the years have always been, you know, the character actors, the guys who aren't the prettiest, you know, leading man
sure.
type people. And that's who I am, I think, as an actor. So, you know, I look at people like that and I'm like, yeah, man, I want to do stuff like that one day.
Yeah. Is this your first experience with him? What did you know of Patton before you heard this, if anything?
Not much, to be honest. I knew his face. He had a very familiar face, and he had popped up in things here and there. And I didn't hear this in 2004 when it came out. I think it was probably around 2008, 2009,
mm-hmm.
somewhere around there. Probably because I was doing a musical at the time back home in Toronto. I was in Evil Dead the Musical, which
awesome.
Was it was an amazing adaptation of the Evil Dead movies and Army of Darkness that some friends from university had put together. That originally was like an indie production. And then it got, like, just kind of picked up and just played everywhere and grew and grew and grew. And then it was off-Broadway. And then mm-hmm. they had just brought it back to Toronto and done, like, a short, very large professional run and saw that there was an even more of a market for it. So they did, like, a 7-8-month run that I was a part of.
Wow.
And in that show, they did such a great job of casting not musical theater actors but comedians, a lot of Second City guys who could sing and dance just well enough to get away with it and do all the fight choreo. But for the most part, they were playing it for comedy. And it was just this kind of wild show that we did for 8 months. And so I was with all these awesome Second City guys, Second City Toronto guys, and they gave me just such a great comedy education. I already had one from my childhood from my dad, but they kind of updated it because it just hadn't been updated in a while. And I think that's when I got into Patton, was around that time.
Okay. Was your... Now, did it stop because you were going to school for acting and, like, your life just became... It became about, like, a different part of the craft, or...
I've always been, like, close with comedy. It's always been really important to me. I guess it was just... I was focused on a different aspect of my career. I had gone to university. I had gotten my drama degree. I went to theater school after that, But I went to theater school to study classical theater. Mm-hmm. So I was in a conservatory acting program doing Shakespeare and Chekhov and, you know, just the heavies. And then I had started my career doing that stuff. And I had done the odd comedy here and there, and I'd done the odd commercial and, you know, making an ass of myself. And that was in Canada. And I found pretty quickly that comedy was my wheelhouse. But usually comedy in Shakespeare or comedy in within drama, that sort of comedic relief that people need in a very heavy play or sure. movie or TV show to sort of ease the tension. I think that still holds true in my career to this day. But mm-hmm. But I was still doing, you know, I was in the world of classical theater and Shakespeare and things like that. And it wasn't until about 2007, 2006, 2007, I actually moved to Berlin, Germany. Mm-hmm. And I was studying improv comedy at that point. Because there was a bunch of expats from New York and England and Canada who were performing in English, doing improv in Berlin. And Berlin Germans, you might be surprised to know this, love improv comedy.
Interesting.
And they have a very good German scene in Berlin. And Berlin is like the wildest city in mm-hmm. Germany. It's almost like its own country the way it is. It's just very different. But it's super artistic, and there's just, you know, any sort of art form is taken to the next level in that city, and improv included. And we had this kind of small English community going on. This was kind of before the expat community really blew up 10 years ago. And so I just started studying improv for the first time. I had done improv classes in theater school and university and things like that, but never at this intensity. And they threw me into the shows really quickly.
Yeah.
So we would be training for a while. They would bring in people and you would train. And then when they thought you were ready, they would throw you right into the fire, which is the best
sure.
way to learn. And so that happened pretty quickly for me because I had a lot of stage experience. So I had pretty good timing, and
okay.
I picked up on things pretty well. And I was a goofy, funny guy, I guess. And that really changed things for me. It really showed me that how much I love and kind of missed that wilder side of comedy as opposed to more structured, scripted side
sure,
of things.
Okay.
And improv has been a big part of my life ever since. Even in like scripted dramas, when I'm working in that, improv I think is the best skill that you can have as a film and TV actor.
Mm-hmm.
It just teaches you to roll with the punches and things like that.
I mean, it takes a certain skill to like kill Matt Frewer and still make it funny. That was the thing that popped into my head today. I'm like, yeah, I don't think I would know anybody who's even worked with him, let alone kill them on screen.
Poor Matt Frewer.
It's sad, but you know.
He's so awesome.
He's amazing. Oh my God. And I was just so shocked to see him in a thing because it had been forever. I might be the only person who remembers his sitcom, Doctor Doctor. Not anybody talks about it. It was a great show. I mean, I think it was. I was nine. But yeah, so it does. It takes a certain skill. So you're talking. So back in
right.
Canada,
back.
This is no. Believe me,
I keep going off.
No,
the
no,
patent
no.
Topic.
My guests normally bring us back on the rails.
Okay.
Okay. So for once, I'm doing my job.
Right.
But so you've got some friends back in Canada, and this becomes is this something that you're putting on repeat constantly?
Yes. I mean, I could. There's a couple things in my life that like if this was, a you know, a podcast about your favorite comedy film, I could go through, like, I could probably recite Tommy Boy line for line, because when I was a kid, that was my film, and Chris Farley was my hero. This is that album for me, I think. I think it's, I've listened to it so many times, and one of my greatest joys in life is to introduce people to the brilliance of Patton Oswalt, and I remember taking a road trip with my sister and throwing this on because we're just kind of going through our iPods and just finding music. I'm like, oh, do you know Patton Oswalt? And we liked laughing. And I mean, who doesn't? the dumbest thing I've ever said. We like to laugh, my sis and I. And I threw this on, and she was pissing her pants. She was howling, and we were killing ourselves. And that was like, I had heard the album so many times at that point. So it was such a joy for me to see someone who I love and respect so much, her opinion, and she's my older sister and eldest sibling, to see her enjoy something for the first time like that was like just, it made the experience so much better.
That's
and
awesome.
Made the album so much better to me as well.
Yeah, that's so good. Now, I will say, I thought I had heard this.
Mm-hmm.
And I think I was probably more familiar with Werewolves and Lollipops.
Yep.
But as I mentioned to you earlier, the gentleman, Dan Schlissel from Stand Up Records, sent me a shitload of records, including Patton's stuff on vinyl. So I re-listened to this, and I did it as part of my little thing. I'm listening to a comedy album a day, or trying to the whole year. And this is when I listened to it. I'm like, I really like it, but I can definitely see that he's grown.
And also, this is dated.
It is 100% dated.
And comedy does that. Sometimes comedy really stands the test of time, and sometimes it doesn't. And I'll be the first to admit that I don't think he would say some of the shit that he says.
No.
He's such a kind man and such a sweet soul.
Yeah.
That I think some of these bits would totally get crossed off the list. I mean, just looking at them, like America, the retarded trust fund kid.
Uh-huh.
We're here, we're queer. You know, apples.
It's mostly things about retarded people.
Exactly.
That he wouldn't say.
Exactly. Because... And also just like talking about like a gay ass moped. Gay. Because back in the day, I went to military school. I talk about this all the bloody time, but I went to military school outside of Philly for high school for 4 years. And it's fresh on my mind because I got back from there last night after my 20th high school reunion at Valley Forge Military Academy.
Awesome.
And so I was there from like 94 to 97.
Mm-hmm.
And like the language of comedy back then, and we loved comedy because we were in a very serious environment, and the military is like kind of a scary as shit place. Can we swear?
Sorry. Please do.
Shit, fuck, piss. Got it out of the way. And so comedy was the thing that you survived on. And for me, comedy, that was my first school of comedy, was military school.
Yeah.
Because I was this tiny little Canadian little pudge ball when I got there.
Mm-hmm.
I was 13 years old when I showed up. And we had students who were, you know, from 13 all the way to 20 or 21 because there was a two-year junior college.
Oh, okay.
And our company was the only company that had academy, high school students, and the two-year junior college students all in one company. And so we had a big age range. So we had big fucking dudes and then like tiny little guys like me who hadn't gone through puberty yet or just starting to.
Yeah.
And it was like Lord of the Flies. It was kids in charge of kids.
Mm-hmm.
And that is a cruel fucking environment.
Yeah.
Or it can be. It's also a wonderful environment and one that I've appreciated for my whole life, and I'm so glad I went there. But man, that place was hard as shit. And so I very quickly realized that I wasn't big enough to defend myself physically. But I observed other kids around me, and the ones who could make the big dudes and the bullies and the jocks and the dumbasses, the ones that could make them laugh, would like stay the fist from hitting them and maybe deflect it off into the kid next to them.
Sure, yeah.
Almost sometimes literally.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you get a guy coming at you ready to punch you, just like on the arm or in the chest or solar plexus, something like that. Never in the face. Sometimes in the face. And if you can make them laugh, it literally stops them in their tracks. And if they're dumb enough, they're just like, and they go to the next guy and just start beating them, who cannot come up with something witty to say. And I saw, like, big, huge, tough, scary dudes get completely disarmed by the sharp tongue of someone who could think on their feet really quickly. So I just started observing those sharp-tongued cadets around me, the ones that weren't the big jocks but were smart and sharp. And they were always able to disarm situations directed at themselves. And I just kind of watched how they did it and like studied it and started doing it and testing it out here and there. And sometimes I'd win and sometimes I'd fail and get punched. But like, you know, eventually you kind of learn through this weird high school violence to be funny, to like think on your feet quickly and entertain people. And then even by the time I was done school or in my last year, I was a first lieutenant platoon leader in charge of a bunch of cadets. And I was an officer. And I would do Matt Foley motivational speaking impressions from Chris Farley from SNL to, you know, get my platoon laughing, entertain them, get them on my side, and then give them orders and, like, you know, give them a break. Let them see the fun side of being a leader and an officer and, like, just kind of find this weird comedic way of leadership. And then I kind of worked on that a little bit. But that was, like, my first comedy school ever.
That's
in terms
crazy.
Of like me physically studying under the threat of violence.
It's amazing.
Yeah, it was a weird environment to do that in, but it worked.
Yeah,
it really worked.
So I imagine the language, because we were talking about the language a bit, was that the language is probably a lot of gay.
That's
this,
right.
Gay
yeah,
that.
So like, oh, don't be so gay.
Sure.
Oh, that's so gay.
Yeah.
And like when we said it at the time, we weren't saying it because, oh, that's so homosexual. Sure. You don't think of it that way. It's just like this word that you use that you throw out, like, oh, don't be so gay. And then as you get older and you go through life, you get educated in university, you meet women because this was an all-boys school, and like, you see what it's like to be in the real world. You're like, oh, yeah, that shit doesn't really play. And it starts to go to the wayside after a while. And so, you know, that sort of rhetoric lasted for a while. But in this day and age, it's just not kosher. You just don't do it. It's not right.
Yeah.
And you'd never catch me doing that in my comedy. And you probably wouldn't catch Patton doing it now. But the cool thing about comedy is it's those who dare to tread a little bit less lightly who will have the stones to get out there and be a little bit controversial, a little bit racy. And you got to find that fine line, because a lot of people don't have that meter.
Sure.
But comedians, I think, who have been around the block, they quickly get that education of what works and what doesn't. But and we certainly know in the age of social media, when you go too far, how that can ruin a career.
Sure.
and screw people over, as well it should. And there's, like, you know, some terrible examples out there.
Sure.
But in comedy, it's the ones who can go a little bit far and be inappropriate, that there's a whole niche there. I'm super inappropriate. I keep a cleaner image, I think, in general, on the day-to-day, especially, like, doing press for things and whatnot. Sure. You gotta be pretty squeaky clean or family-friendly. But when I'm on Comedy Bang Bang or something like that, I feel free to, like, be my completely filthy self.
Yeah. Well, and the thing about that is, and I think the thing about this is, there is a contract that is invisible that you sign. I don't know that his audience was different then than it is now. Maybe they've grown. I mean, I know I have. I would have liked this then. I would have completely dismissed him saying retard a bunch because I'm like, he's just joking, which he was.
Yeah.
Yes. I don't think there's no ill will meant at all here.
No.
He's not a mean dude. I think he's talked about he was a lot angrier then, which is one of the reasons I think his stuff's developed a little bit better, too.
But that's another great thing about him is that he's clearly someone who has a touch of the darkness in him, and I don't know that many comedians who don't.
Sure.
You know, but he's great. He's in that he knows how human he is, and he talks about it. I mean, half of his routine is self-deprecating, and the other half is observational about the world around him, but, you know, he's always quick to go back and to humble himself in front of people.
Sure.
But I think, where was I going with this point? I can't remember. I was just praising the man. Fuck. What was that?
I can only go back to what I was saying, that there's a social contract signed with your audience.
Yeah.
And that it's the same with Comedy Bang Bang. Like, there's a lot of shit I wouldn't put up with on other shows.
Totally.
Because of that. Like, for instance, I'm so sorry, I can't remember his name. He does Ming. There's a real good chance, you know.
Yeah.
Like, I even question my enjoyment of that character a lot, even though I know it's, you know, there's lots of line walking.
Oh, yeah.
How many times did you have sex on that last episode of Comedy Bang Bang?
So many times.
And it was, like, great. And it was a delight.
I came a lot on that
show.
Yeah,
you really did. And it was it was delightful. But
I never come on podcasts. I'm sorry. Maybe I will today. I don't know. I just don't know.
There's a contract you sign where you know what the audience expects, and therefore, you know, there's a tacit agreement that I'm not shitting on you if I cross this line.
Yeah.
Because you've heard worse or whatever.
Totally. And there's that. I was thinking about this today. Even on my way here, I was looking at people, and I was in a Lyft, in a ride share, and I was looking at other people in their cars, because what else are you going to look at?
Sure.
And there's so many people driving this town. We're in Los Angeles. And there's people who are just driving, and they're laughing their asses off. And this is such a car-heavy town and a traffic-heavy town. And I feel like comedy albums and podcasts, comedy podcasts, is kind of the saving grace from road rage. I think there's less incidences of people just, like, pulling a gun out of their driver's side or passenger side, you know, thing and shooting people. There's less of that because people are, like, finding podcasts and comedy albums to laugh and just take, you know, the time away. And I see people laughing their ass off in cars all the time, and they're not having conversations. I think they're, you know, listening to albums, and it's... Well, fuck, what was my point on that, too? God damn it.
If only I was inside your head.
Yeah, get in here.
I'm so
get sorry. The F in here. But I find it's one of those towns where comedy holds sway here. It's a very powerful element to Los Angeles. It's a make or break place for comedy. I mean, if you're a good stand up, you're going to potentially get your own sitcom one day.
Sure.
And you're going to be cemented into the Hollywood Walk of Fame and the annals of comedy history. But because we've got these little boxes that we can drive in and listen to comedy or in our earphones, we can listen to the most inappropriate shit and nobody knows it. And and that's what I love about comedy is we can be the deepest, darkest, dirtiest side of ourselves inside our head with these comedy albums playing in our ears. And it's completely personal and nobody else has to know. Or we can share it at a comedy club if it's like a super blue night that is being produced or whatever. It's part of that contract that we sign as audience members, whether it's we're in an audience or whether we're just one person listening, walking down the street and laughing our ass off.
Yeah.
And we, you know, it's such a fluid currency because we pick and choose who we listen to. It's, sure. you know, completely subjective like that. So we go as dirty as we want to be. And, you know, if we want to listen to the Bill Hickses and the, you know, Lenny Bruces and look at the history of some of the blue comedy out there and go all the way up to, like, you know, David Cross, who says incredibly inappropriate things, but it's so deliciously delivered at the same time that you groan and laugh at the same time. We get to choose that, which is great. Doesn't mean that we have to go around talking like that.
Right. Right. Yeah. 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 And I mean, you also have to, there are a lot of people, audience-wise and people who are listening on the outside who don't understand that there's a character on stage,
totally.
And that's a huge part of it. And I've been guilty of that myself.
Yeah.
Like, for instance, I have no interest in separating Andrew Dice Clay from Andrew Dice Clay.
Totally.
I can't listen to it. That said, yeah. I mean, I talked about it with Greg Turkington the other day, and it was a great conversation, but I still don't give a fuck about Andrew Dice Clay.
Yeah.
And I don't think you could get me to.
Yeah.
That said, I listened to this, and I'm like, If I had heard this first and didn't know Patton now, like me, 36-year-old me, listens to this now, I'd be like, I don't know if I want to hear more. I like it.
That's fair.
But I don't know if I want to hear more. And that was my review when I re-listened. I'm like, I don't know if I'd like this as much as I thought I would. But on re-listening to it, I was like, okay, there's a lot of value here. I'm just, you know, I'm a more sensitive human being.
Totally. And so am I. But I do let my inappropriate side revel in it a little bit. But I was actually surprised, because I think it's been a few years since I listened to it, and I was surprised by, pardon me, I'm just gonna burp into the microphone, I was surprised by how much I was like, like, you know, cringing more than usual when I listened to it. So, you know, I definitely was shocked by that, because the Patton Oswalt that I know is the most recent Patton Oswalt, and he's not exactly like that. But I mean, his delivery, like, if you want to look at the science of his stand-up in this album, it's on point. He
absolutely
is in perfect form. And when I was listening to it in headphones, I don't know what it was, but the version that I had, I heard so much more of the audience in this version than I had ever heard before when I listened to it.
Okay.
Yeah, and like, there's a shit ton of heckling that goes on.
I know.
And later on in the show, he's like, thanks for, you know, sticking around so late. So obviously, like, this is an audience that's pretty drunk.
Yes.
He's even got, like, the two more sips thing going on, which makes me laugh so hard. And that's, like, a brilliant piece of audience work that he does. Because there's so much peppering going in by the audience that you hear, that I heard in my headphones, that he's working on he's in such good shape as a stand-up at this point that he's working at such a fast level that he's able to maintain his set. Also the pauses that are required for audience, you know, for laughter and whatnot, but he's also able to weed out and ignore a bunch of the stupid, useless, chippering that's going on from the crowd and also, like, mine it for gold. And like, two more sips is like one of the best moments on the album, and it's completely off the cuff. With some, you know, drunk dude yelling, two more sips, when his, you know, huge glass of Merlot comes. And then he goes off on this hilarious rant about two more sips and where that leads. And, you know, it's brilliant. It's great. Yeah. And he finds a way to sort of tie it into another bit of his. It's just total, like, the science of his stand-up at this point is completely on point. It moves at a great clip. He gives the right amount of time. I mean, obviously, he knows what he's doing. Like, anybody who has an album that anybody knows about, they're obviously, like, experts at the science. They've put in the hours, they've tested the material, they've done it over and over, they've taken it on the road, they've bombed with it, they've done well with it. and they know what they're doing, but it's just like a masterclass, I think, in terms of working an audience.
There's a nice opposition to it at one point, too, where I can't remember the bit specifically. He's singing a part of a song, and there's a woman you can hear who wants to sing the entire fucking song and keeps going.
Yeah.
And he just talks over her until he just does his bit.
Just drowns her out.
Yep, and it works perfectly.
Totally. He shuts her up. She's wanting attention, or she's drunk enough that she wants to be a part of it. And, he just drones her out, and then eventually she gets the point, and she just shuts up. And
yeah, it's perfect.
Yeah, yeah. It's amazing. When I go and see stand-up shows, and I'll go to, like, the indie rooms, and I haven't been to the Comedy Store yet, but I really want to check that out.
Yeah.
But when I go and see stand-up, it's fascinating to watch how different people work with hecklers, how it shuts them down, ruins their set, makes their set. I mean, it's one of the best parts of seeing live stand-up comedy, because that's the improv element right there. And if you don't have improv skills as a stand-up comedian, if you're just, you know, a one-man show and you can only really do what you've scripted and worked on, you're screwed. You're not going to make it.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Women as well. Sorry. Men and women. You don't have to be just a man to do stand-up. I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry.
This is the guy who comes on podcasts. It's really okay. I think they understand.
Yeah.
Now, so after this, I mean, did you become more familiar with him just as an actor, as a presence? Did you listen to his other albums?
Yeah. Okay. Started consuming his other stuff as it came out, or, you know, whatever was in the back catalog. And also just seeing him pop up here and there on things in small roles. And I always love when he shows up somewhere. It just makes me so happy, because I'm like, oh, there's Patton. This is great. And he actually was one of the first guys who got on board with Orphan Black.
Really?
And because he's got such a good, strong social media presence. Mm-hmm. And that's another thing that I love watching him on is Twitter.
Yeah.
Because he's very political, and he's very outspoken, and he gets into the arguments. And he really starts going down the rabbit hole with people. And it is glorious to watch, because not many people are sharper than him, if any. So good luck to you if you're going to try and troll him on Twitter, because he will school the shit out of you. And it's so entertaining to the rest of us. There's very few people who dare to do that. Don Cheadle is another guy on Twitter who is just incredible and hilarious and gets into it with people. Like, you know he enjoys it, because he just slays people left, right, and center on that thing.
Yeah.
But Patton is like that. So whenever I see him pop up, I get pretty thrilled. Oh, I was talking about Orphan Black. So he got behind Orphan Black really early and was, like, tweeting about it. And Orphan Black was a show that it's a quirky, weird show. It shouldn't necessarily work on paper.
Right.
And yet it I think, got a great following and still has. We've got one more season left to go, which we've wrapped, but comes out in June. June 10th. BBC America. And fifth and final season. he got on board of the show and really started tweeting about it and helping grow our audience. And it was that first season, and it was like him and a few other people with a good following. Really, the show grew on social media more than anything, because it's a weird little show. It doesn't have a lot of money for advertising. It doesn't have any big stars on it to, you know, put behind the advertising.
Sure.
We're a quirky Canadian show set in Canada on BBC America.
Right.
So it's like, it's a sci-fi show starring, you know, at that time, a relatively unknown actress from Regina, Saskatchewan. Uh-huh. So you're just like, Tatiana Maslany, Emmy Award winner. you know, it was just like, it was just weird enough that it kind of took off. And Patton was one of those guys behind it. And I remember watching the finale, I think it was the second season. Watching the finale at one of our showrunner's house, Graham Manson, who's our head writer and co-creator. And we're watching this finale and live tweeting about it. And then I got this Twitter message in my box from Patton Oswalt saying, like, how much he enjoyed the season. And
holy shit.
It's made my year. It's made my last 3 years. It made me so happy. And we had, like, a quick exchange of thank you so much, I'm a big fan, blah, 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 to him and stuff. And it was, like, one of the coolest moments in my life. To at least e-meet one of my heroes. I was just like, oh, my God, this is incredible.
Jesus.
Couldn't believe it. And, like, after that, I was just, like, trying to get him on the show so hard to, like,
course.
Be Donnie's brother. We were kicking around the idea of bringing him on as Donnie's brother, older brother. And, Oh, I would have loved that. That would have been great.
So good.
Yeah.
God damn it.
Well, it's not a main storyline, so they got to put the money where the main storyline is.
Of course, of course.
I'm forever relegated to the B story.
The thing is, every time you're talking about seeing him pop up and stuff, because you and I were talking about News Radio beforehand, mm-hmm. he does have a bit part in News Radio.
That's
very
perfect.
Quickly, very quickly. You're Bill McNeil. That's basically all he says. But he got to meet Phil Hartman, so I mean, you know.
Another hero of mine. Phil Hartman, I mean, he's part of that era of Saturday Night Live. For me, that was everything.
Of course.
It's funny. I was listening to the Scott Aukerman episode of this podcast. Mm-hmm. And because Scott is...
Oh, God, when I was a horrible interviewer. Interesting.
Okay. No, it was great. It was great. Okay. You guys had a great conversation, and I think it was like episode 31 or something like that.
Yeah.
It was back in the day. But it's funny because Scott is now a friend of mine, and I've done his podcast 5 times now.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just, it's so weird because now I'm getting into the mode of my career and my life. And now that I've moved to Los Angeles, fresh off the boat, I am an immigrant, with papers. So please, thank you. I'm starting to meet and get to know my heroes. And that is mind blowing to me.
Uh-huh.
And he was talking about that with, you know, I mean, probably by now he's met Mel Brooks. He's talking about Mel Brooks and Carl Reiner on his episode.
Yep, yep.
And so he's like of a generation kind of before me in comedy. He's not that much older than me, but mm-hmm. in terms of his comedy and what he was tuned into, he's the generation before me, I would mm-hmm. say. And he talks about the 85 season of SNL with Billy Crystal.
Yeah,
and
wow, okay.
Some of those people. And for me, it's funny how Saturday Night Live has kind of influenced people over the years in different generations. For me, it was the, like, 91 to 95, 96, 97 era.
Yep.
Like the Chris Farley, of course, David Spade, Adam Sandler.
Mike Myers.
Mike Myers, Dana Carvey, Phil Hartman. So many. I mean, like, every single person that went through there, Jan Hooks, like, everybody just... was perfect. Tim Meadows, it was brilliant. And even having people who are, you know, who are behind the scenes, the writers now kind of coming into their own, it's incredible to watch how they influence every generation of people who kind of come through pop culture. So that was my era that influenced me, and Phil Hartman was like one of those guys, and doing impressions of characters that we saw. And we didn't have YouTube, we didn't have, you know, literally when I was at military school, we were just getting the internet for the first time on dial-up modems, and it was slow as hell. Like, couldn't watch things. You just had to catch it live and hope that someone popped a VHS in the tape player and recorded it. And my dad would do that for me. He did that. I was born in 79. So around the time, so when Simpsons came out,
mm-hmm.
I was a kid. And I think it was like Thursday nights it came out. It was either Thursday nights or Sundays. I forget. It flipped back and forth between those days at one point. And my dad would like put in the VHS and tape. He would tape things for me. He would tape Simpsons. He would tape Saturday Night Live, Kids in the Hall,
mm-hmm.
SCTV. And now, not really SCTV because it was kind of past that at that point. David Letterman top tens he would film because
awesome.
He loved David Letterman.
Awesome.
So he would like record the top tens for me. And my parents were divorced. They divorced when they were 4, and we had some really rough years. And the only way I think that my dad and I connected, because we're very different people, he's passed on now, but was through comedy.
Yeah.
And he gave me my first comedy education more than anything. He had a great sense of humor. Super funny guy. He was kind of dry himself, but he loved to laugh, and he loved to fuck with people a little bit. And he gave me my first sort of comedy education. And I didn't even realize that until literally like 2 or 3 years ago. I was doing an interview for a movie that I was in and talking about my influences. It was just an over the phone interview. I'm sitting in my car and I started talking. My dad had died in 2002.
Mm-hmm.
And so I was sitting in my car doing this phone interview, and it dawned on me that this comedy education and my love for comedy all came from my father. And he's a figure that I've kind of gone back and forth on since he died, you know, in our relationship, whether I'm angry at him or love him, like,
sure.
You know, always love him. But like, there's just things that really affected me. And I realized that he gave me this amazing gift because it was the only common ground we had, or you know, it might have been found because at first it was just like, well, you know, we don't have to talk. We can just sit there and watch something. And mm-hmm. I like it and he likes it. So, you know, it's kind of easy that way. And we became, you know, a pair in that we'd love to go and see movies, or we'd love to watch comedy or rent a film. And, like, it's not the most social activity between sure. a father and son, but it's something that we really enjoyed mm-hmm. and both got something out of. And, you know, it's stuff that I'm doing today in a career. So it's like, it's obviously something that made me who I am.
Yeah.
I didn't realize that till a couple of years ago. So I started crying in this interview. No. I started bawling. I'm like, I'm sorry. I was getting all choked up. Oh. I mean, at least it was a phone interview for I think it was for an article.
Okay.
But like, you know, it was one of those things that it dawned on me, but that era of like VHS comedy for me was, mm-hmm. was my introduction to everything. And I owe it to the old man. But back in the day, like, you had to catch it. You almost had to yeah. catch it live, especially Saturday Night Live, and because people were talking about it around the water cooler, around school, around wherever, and it spread like that. So I find that comedy from the era that I got it, and maybe the comedy or the era before, maybe it's just because I'm nostalgic, but it's stronger because mm-hmm. it spread on its own merits, not because it was easy to click to and watch.
I see what you're saying.
You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
That's such an old fuddy-duddy thing to say. Oh, it
is, but we're at that age right
come
now.
Come on, I'm 37. 100%. I feel like I'm 25, but
mm-hmm. No, I get it.
I'm not.
The internet hit at a very crucial time
yeah.
for us,
yeah.
like in a way where it changed everything. And
yeah. Luckily, we were at the age where we could like jump onto it as
of
well.
Of course,
and get
but
it.
I also think we had premature nostalgia for everything.
Sure.
And yeah. and not to in any way dismiss your love of those things, because I have the same love for yep. almost all the same shit.
Yeah.
Although I am interested in what kind of Canadian influences you I have to ask every Canadian
yeah.
guest, because
sure.
it's a thing that doesn't people will talk about, you know, like Lorne Michaels' early sketch group that I have never heard still.
Right.
So I'm curious what stuff was there that I might not have
first
gotten.
It was SCTV.
Sure.
Which I liked as a kid, but I don't think has aged as well as, like, if I went back and watched old school SCTV,
mm-hmm.
I wouldn't enjoy it now as much as when I was a kid.
Sure.
But I definitely appreciate those performers. So those guys, John yeah. Candy was another huge influence on me, another, because sure. I was a chubby kid and, you know, that's something that's always followed me my whole life and my psyche. And I idolized those chubby dudes that went out there and made the world laugh, and whether it was with their bodies, but also with their wit and
sure.
with their heart. And these are guys that had big hearts, like John Candy, massive heart,
mm-hmm.
Chris Farley, huge heart. I loved those guys.
Yeah.
And people loved them. And, you know, both of them gone way too soon.
Oh, yeah.
Way too soon.
Yeah.
Broke my heart. I mean, when Chris Farley died, people were calling my brother, friends of my brother were calling him being like, is your brother okay?
Cause, oh, shit.
Like,
yeah.
cause you know, it was devastating. And my best friends and I, we loved Chris Farley. We'd watch those movies all the time. We would quote them all the time. We would do impressions and, you know, they're not the best films at all. I know that, but they're
sure,
just, they're
but
so important to me because there's a leading man who's a big dude. And like, that's awesome.
Yeah.
But the SCTV, those guys, Eugene Levy and Catherine O'Hara and like that whole crew was a huge influence on me, and I love them to death and I cherish them and they're very important to me. But SCTV now doesn't feel as funny to me.
Okay.
I think it's more in the production values.
Sure.
I think because looks so 70s, even though it's the 80s, it just looks so 70s and old school that I can't watch it.
Yeah.
When
I watch it, I always feel like they're just waiting to come to America and change
completely,
all of comedy. That
completely.
Is all, honestly what it feels
and they
like.
Do. These are people
yep.
who revolutionized comedy.
Mm-hmm.
This crew of hilarious Canadians. And we don't really have a star culture in Canada
mm-hmm.
unless you come to the U.S. and make a name for yourself there. And
okay.
then we have famous Canadians.
Okay.
There's very few homegrown that stay within the country. We've got some,
yeah.
but it's just not within our nature because we can't compete with the juggernaut that is just south of our border,
yeah.
you guys, whose culture is seemingly the same or very similar,
sure.
but in fact is very different,
mm-hmm.
very different people in our mindset. And there's many reasons for that. I mean, that's government, it's church and state influence. It's all these things
sure.
that are different in our countries. But comedy has been something that has always been important to Canadians and has always come out of Canada. And I think it comes from that little brother syndrome, mm-hmm. where it's like, hey, you know, like pulling on the shirt of their big brother, you guys, and just being like, hey, 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 look, I'm going to make you laugh. Like that whole mentality. And I'm the youngest of five, if you include my two step siblings. So maybe that's where I get it from a little bit. But mm-hmm. Certainly SCTV, Kids in the Hall was a huge one for me.
Sure.
It is a miracle. If you know the Canadian Broadcast Corporation, the CBC, that's our public broadcaster. If you know how they operate in terms of creating content, they're always very good on comedy. And right now they're killing it with comedy.
Mm-hmm.
They've got great shows on right now. Because they've kind of learned to let go a little bit and not be so hands-on about things. But
sure.
Kids in the Hall came around at a time when, I don't know how Lorne Michaels, who was producing it, I don't know how he got it to stick on CBC, but this was like a controversially bizarre sketch show.
Uh-huh.
That was way ahead of its time in its social commentary, and its use of drag and homosexual, like gay culture, LGBT mm-hmm. culture. And, you know, this is like early 90s stuff that's being done. These guys were doing it out of a little bar called the Rivoli in the back room that does awesome comedy in Toronto. It's been there for years and years and years. But the CBC is like notorious for controlling everything and rewriting, getting their network hands on things. And that's understandable. It's a public broadcaster. They answer to the people. They answer to the government who funds them.
Sure.
So it's, you know, it's understandable, but still it doesn't help anybody.
Right.
They take on Kids in the Hall, this group of five, you know, weirdo dudes, and they're all weirdos, and misfits. And they're just like, yeah, Lauren, you can take your five guys and just do your thing. We'll play you late at night and like whatever.
Yeah. Yeah.
So they didn't touch them.
Wow.
And they got away with like the craziest shit year after year. And then it took off. And I think Comedy Central picked it up
mm-hmm.
in the States. And then it really blew up. I mean, that's the key for any country around the world. You guys don't know this because you just produce in America and then it goes out to the world.
Sure.
For everybody else around the world, a lot of people produce for the American market, which is a good thing and a bad thing.
Mm-hmm.
It kind of stunts your own national identity in yep. what you're creating and doing. Because you're trying to emulate a U.S. method of doing things
of
with less budget, with sometimes a different language, mm-hmm. And comedy doesn't translate between languages. And, you know, the French have their way of doing things that's mm-hmm. different than the Germans, certainly, and different than the British and, you know, the North Americans. So everybody wants a show to go to the United States because that's a big market. And once it hits the States, then it can bounce around the world. It's kind of this weird effect. But
yeah.
But you guys influence culture more than anybody else in the world. And even cultures that hate your guts
uh-huh.
still love American culture. It's very
right.
odd. I mean,
right.
Coca-Cola is everywhere. McDonald's is everywhere. All these products that are so Americana get around the world, even in countries where there's armed conflict against you guys.
Yes.
And pure hatred. So it's this kind of weird catch-22 that goes on with culture. So to get a Canadian show to come to the States and blow up will remind the country where it comes from, or at least a country like Canada.
Yeah.
And what makes us, I think, a little bit unique is that we're stuck between the eagle and the crown, the eagle mm-hmm. being you guys, the crown being England.
Yeah.
In our culture, we don't quite have a national identity yet.
Yeah.
I think our Quebecois, our French-Canadian culture in Quebec is very strong, and they know what they're going for, and they actually have a stronger entertainment and star power system and industry than we do in English in the Anglo side of things. Newfoundland is a province in Canada. It's an island out in the North Atlantic.
Mm-hmm.
They have their own culture. It's a very strong, hilarious island culture. Great artists that come out of there. But as a whole country, we really don't quite have our Anglo identity figured out yet, because we're like, well, are we American? Are we English? And sure. we're not. We're our own thing.
Yeah.
But we sound similar enough to you guys that, and we dress similar enough, and our cities look similarly the same as you mm-hmm. guys, that it's hard for us to identify where the differences lie. So for us to produce a show, we want it to be just like yours because we think we can easily pass it off down here. And that's sure. not always the case.
Right.
Especially with a tenth of the budget, because we have a tenth of the population, a tenth of the market.
Sure.
It's different when, you know, Little Britain, a show, you know, a very funny, repetitive sketch comedy show in the UK hits off over here, or The Office, the UK Office.
Sure.
You understand why it does, because it's so quirky in English and really plays up its culture perfectly. and doesn't try to be American. It does its own thing.
Yeah.
And that's what works better than anything else. It's like trying to be cool. You can never be cool if you try to be cool. You just be yourself.
Right.
And like be your own quirky weirdo self. And like that's 100% more cooler than if you're trying to be cool. It's the same thing with production. But Kids in the Hall changed the game. Like it really changed comedy down here as well. It changed sketch because I think when they came around, Saturday Night Live was in that transition period coming out of the 80s into this new crew of young, awesome guys. But they were struggling and they were finding, I think their numbers were down even. And like people just didn't know what sketch comedy was anymore.
Yeah.
And I mean, we had In Living Color in the 80s and things like that, but that didn't last long. But I loved In Living Color as well. Because that was like a world that I just didn't know. It was very West Coast feeling. And it was a culture that I didn't know in like little old Toronto. So it was fascinating to watch that and really revel in it and enjoy it. But Kids in the Hall was very Canadian.
Yep.
Distinctly Canadian.
Yep.
With like Canadian police officers who are total Canadian knob jobs. And, you know, just the quirkiest, weirdest characters that I had ever seen on TV. Stuff that was not safe at all. It was late night TV.
Yeah.
And Saturday Night Live has always been safe. It never really pushes the edges because it's NBC and it's network and it's still, you know, 11:30 to 1 a.m. But like it's still got to be clean enough. It can't really go down a certain road. But Kids in the Hall was queer in every sense of the word.
Yeah.
And proudly so. And I think really push things forward for so many things in society, in North American culture, in a subversive way. And I'm so proud of that show, and I still love it. And I can watch that show and still really enjoy it. And there are some episodes that are so dry, but at the same time, they'll do subtle comedy, they'll do broad comedy, they'll do really shticky characters, and they'll do like really dry, underhanded stuff. Like there's a sketch where Bruce McCullough wakes up in the middle of the night and he's just like in so much pain and he's just starts chugging this massive pitcher of water and you see him chug like this whole pitcher of water and then he like burps this very nasty burp and he's like, it's that goddamn salted pork, and like his wife wakes up and they just have this argument about this salty pork dinner and that's the whole sketch and you're just like, are you kidding me? I've been there. I think five times out of seven, you know, nights of the week, I'm waking up with that feeling, chugging water in the middle of the night.
Yeah.
And I'm like, God damn, I had too much salt at night. And I think of that sketch, and it's, we're getting way off patent now.
No, it's but okay,
like,
though.
It's those influences that, and there's so much in this album, you know, like that salty pork sketch. There's so many things in this album that I didn't even realize. Like, I'm just looking down here. I'm trying to think of some of the sayings that pop up in my head and I just say off the cuff on, you know, from day to day. There's so many things that come from Patton Oswalt, that come from Chris Farley, that I'll say that I, you know, when I go back and listen to things like this, that I didn't even realize that this was the origin of it.
Right. Yeah.
Maybe if I thought about it for 5 minutes, it'd be like, oh, right. That's where I get flippity-doo from or something like that.
I was
like,
going to say,
you know,
I wonder how many
like
times he says it on this fucking album.
Yeah, yeah. So flippity-jabbity-doo, like, which is a very Adam Sandler-sounding thing as well.
Yeah, yeah.
So there's, like, something dated about that, but I just
well,
love it.
Well, he invented to a lot of comedy language in a way. Like, in a way, like, people aped stuff to that they're still aping and don't realize they should stop, which is like, this is a bowl filled with sorrow and deliciousness. Like, he invented that.
He did, and he's so literary.
Yeah.
Which is what I love about him. He's smart, and he makes these offhanded, like, literary references. He'll drop them in there, and then when people cheer, he'll be like, oh, apparently we got some English majors in the audience. Yeah. Like, it's great. Like, his audience, I think people are better read than people realize.
Sure.
It's almost like creating content for kids.
Mm-hmm.
Don't dumb it down. Kids are incredibly smart. They're very sharp, and they are the toughest audience you will ever meet. I've done children's theater. I did children's theater, like, right out of theater school. Like, we're talking nightmare gigs.
Mm-hmm.
And it was like, you got to, like, cut your teeth on this shit. This is, like, pay your dues.
Yeah, yeah,
children's
yeah.
theater. It's, like, gouge my eyes out, my soul, my poor soul. What am I doing? But, like, I got to pay my bills on $300 Canadian a week.
Sure.
Like, doing a shitty show in a bear costume. It's that stuff that... Fuck, where was I going with that one? I got onto a bear costume.
Well, what it's making me think of, though, is that you were saying that the audience is very smart, and that was a big part of it. And one of the things I like about this, and equally about Kids in the Hall, is I never felt talked down to. Yeah. I never feel talked down to with this. Although you did make me think, one interesting thing about Kids in the Hall just for a split second is I don't think I knew what Canadian felt like. For a while, just felt, oh, this is just an alternate universe of Americans. And then once I knew they were Canadian, I'm like, oh, I get it now. It feels surreal, but then if I look at it now, I'm like, yes, surreal for sure. But also, it's a surreality that is tinged with Canadianness without being Canadian content.
There's stuff, two, you know, Canadian, I mean, identities out there. There's, mm-hmm, the confused one that we have ourselves as, uh-huh, Canadians. And then there's this confused one that the rest of the world has because...
The McKenzie brothers.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
I love the McKenzie brothers. Of course, I mean, Strange Brew was another movie, sure, growing up. Now, my brother and I would wake up at 5 in the morning on a Saturday before the rest of the house. We would watch Dukes of Hazzard on TV, uh-huh, and our Dukes of Hazzard, and then throw on this beat-up old tape of Strange Brew and, like, get in our sleeping bags and give each other steamrollers and, like... and, like, roll over each other and quote that movie. I could quote that movie as well. And that is, like, a cartoon version of Canada crossed, uh-huh, with Hamlet. It's brilliant. It's ridiculous. And that's that SCTV crew. But, you know, the rest of the world doesn't really know what Canada is. They just look at it as, like, oh, you guys are so nice and you're clean, sure, and you're polite. And we are. I mm-hmm, honestly think that is a true kind of lineup of things that we are. Another thing that I think a lot of people think of is, you know, well, because of that, you guys don't have an edge. You're kind of boring. And they're kind of right. I, mm-hmm, honestly think that there's something a little bit safe and boring about Canada. And I kind of like that. I dig that.
Mm-hmm.
When I go home, it's like a breath of fresh air. Sometimes literally when, you know, when you're in nature, when you're in the woods, and I crave getting out of, you know, cities and going to forests. I think that's not an inherently Canadian thing, but we do love that in, mm-hmm, Canada. Because we got so effing much of it. But there is something kind of boring inherently about Canada.
Okay.
Because it's safe. And there's something edgy about the United States and about your cities. They're dangerous. They're scary sometimes.
Yep.
This city scares the shit out of me. I just moved here. I'm, like, constantly on edge.
I understand that.
And it's funny listening to parts of this album.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
He's talking about living on Normandy, which, yep, I live near there in a really kind of crappy neighborhood.
Mm-hmm.
And because it's affordable and I'm converting all my money from Canadian, which really fucking sucks.
Mm.
Someone please hire me. Mm-hmm. So I can make some American money. But it's he's talking about, you know, moving to that area and then hearing what he sounds like a Dutch woman having an argument with this and that and the other thing. I'm like, oh my God, I never realized that the many times I've listened to this album until now. I'm like, uh-huh, Jesus, that's my back alley.
Right.
Where,
right,
it's like in the middle of the night, I'll wake up to someone, like a couple people in this fucking terrible fight and being like, what the fuck is going on? And I'll look out my window and it's one dude like arguing with himself.
Yep.
And, yep, pushing, like, two massive carts full of stuff behind. And he talks about what the buildings are like here and whatnot. And I'm like, yeah, this sounds kind of familiar. This, uh-huh, is totally different now. And it's kind of cool to see an album that, yeah, it does get dated in moments. But I'm going to make this comparison, and it's going to be the cheesiest, dumbest comparison ever and not completely on point. But it's like the play Hamlet, where it's not – this is not the Hamlet of comedy albums, uh-huh, but – but the play of Hamlet is a play that I have gone through so many different phases of life reading. It's one of my favorite plays of all time.
Mm-hmm.
I used to hate it. I used to thought it was so boring. I refused to read it through theater school and through university, which I don't know how I made it through those two institutions without reading Hamlet. But I wanted to be a rebel.
Okay.
And I was like, fuck you. I'm going to do my own thing. Fuck. This is the best play ever. I don't need to read it. Fuck off. I don't care. Like, it was the most arrogant, stupid thing I've ever done. And I'm not like that normally. And then my dad died, and then I was cast in a production of Hamlet, and it was like, oh my God, what the fuck was I thinking? This is a play that as I read it or see it, and I love to see versions of Hamlet. It's one of my favorite plays. And, mm-hmm, so it changes with you as you get older. You get different perspectives on different scenes and things like that. It's cool to just, I'm not saying this is the Hamlet of comedy albums. It's cool to see portions of it feel new or different to me because, sure, my life has changed.
Yeah.
So there's something really neat about that. And I think you can say that about all things. But like we discussed, it's dated in places.
Sure.
It's got language and things that I don't find as funny anymore. And then there's parts of me that laugh quietly to myself because I'm like, this is so inappropriate, but I'm just going to enjoy it for now.
Sure.
But it does have parts of it that have changed with me, and I never realized that, and I think that's so cool.
Yeah. No, I noticed that, too, in listening to it. I'm like, oh, fuck, I might have lived right near there as well. You know,
I know these references all of a sudden.
Yeah. And it's, I don't know, it's fun to listen to, again, to know where somebody not started. This is obviously he'd been in the game for a while.
Yeah,
but
I think he started doing stand-up around 89 right. or something like that, and working, like, shitty, really, really shitty little rooms, but... Mm-hmm.
But this is still 13 fucking years ago, and to know where he's come from there is mm-hmm. kind of mind-blowing to me.
Absolutely.
And then I think he's an accomplished actor. He's very funny. The fucking new Mystery Science Theater, he's so great in it.
I haven't got to him yet.
He's
like, I
so
just
good in it.
Started watching it, and I can't wait to... No, I've seen him very briefly.
Yeah. They're great.
I can't wait to get into that.
They meet the spirit of the original show. I know it's completely sidetracked.
No.
Shit, but you know.
Oh, really? Have we been doing sidetrack this whole time?
No. On point every time, as every with every time. Episode of this fucking show.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. You know what? Actually, what we didn't talk about, we did talk about your influences with your dad and stuff, and a lot of people have that. Like,
sure.
I think, honestly, my influences were heavier into TV and movie. People are like, oh, you must be an expert in comedy albums. I'm not. That's why I do this fucking show.
Cool.
But, like, you know, I want to learn what other... So, did you have any comedy albums growing up? Was there any stuff in the house?
So, in terms of, like, vinyl, if you want to talk about vinyl,
either way honestly,
I grew up, so I was born in 79, and in my house, in the first house I grew up in, we lived there for maybe the first 4 years of my life until my parents got divorced. I have memories of that house. I have memories of the bookcase, which was my bookcase until I just moved to LA. I actually just gave it away.
Mm-hmm.
Which kind of just right now broke my heart a little bit. Yeah, I remember that bookcase as a kid. That's where... So on that case, there was, like, a little sort of lower part with four drawers and then, like, a bookshelf. On the main part, just on top of the little shelving unit at the bottom, that's where we had our record player and then a whole bunch of records beside that. And I remember as like, a really small toddler, like, learning to take out... It's just like watching my nieces now, like when they are like working a phone and like at the age of one or two, they know how to like zoom in on pictures
shit.
On an iPhone. You're like, Jesus Christ, can't be healthy. But like when I was a kid, it was like, oh, look at all these like fun vinyls to play with. And you pull them out. And I still have some of them from when I was a kid.
Mm.
None of them are really comedy ones. Some of the kids ones I had
sure.
are fun. There's like the Muppets, Musicians of Bremen and like...
yeah,
I remember that. You wouldn't know this reference. It's a Canadian one, Jacob Tutu and the Hooded Fang by Mordecai Richler, as read by Sir Christopher Plummer.
That is the most Canadian thing that I've ever heard.
Oh,
sure.
Completely.
Outside of Christopher Plummer, sure.
Yeah, Mordecai Richler is a famous, I think he's a Montrealer, famous author. He wrote Duddy Kravitz and... so many very adult books, but he also wrote Jacob Tutu and the Hooded Fang, which is a famous kid's book in Canada.
I love it.
About mm-hmm. this kid who repeats everything he says. He repeats everything he says. And, you know, that's the whole shtick.
Mm-hmm.
But I remember those albums and, like, listening to those a lot, like, learning how to put those on vinyl, and, like, they're scratched to shit now, probably because of me. But my older brother and sister, they were... My brother was, like, 4.5 years older than me. My sister, 5.5. So they were already, like, well-versed in how to use that.
Mm-hmm.
But that was my first experience with vinyl and, let's say, spoken word
sure.
vinyl. And, like, listening to things like that. Like Muppets. Like, kids' vinyl records.
Mm-hmm.
I love that stuff. I sold a lot of my stuff when I moved down here a couple months ago. So... one of the things I sold was my record player. So I right now don't have one.
Uh-huh.
And all my records, I kept the ones that I really like. They're in storage right now in Toronto. But one day maybe I'll release them and get them down here. We'll
mm-hmm.
see. We'll see how long I last down here.
Mm-hmm.
Who knows? This is like a time capsule.
Uh-huh.
You can listen to this. This is 2017. It's May 1st. It's May 1st, 2017 right
it
now.
It is, yeah.
Are we allowed to say that? When do you release this?
I can release it whenever's convenient. Okay, for you, whatever you need it.
Well,
honestly.
It's May 1st, 2017. It's a time capsule. We'll see where I am. You can listen to this 2 years from now, mm-hmm. audience, and maybe I'll be successful. Maybe you never hear from me again. Maybe you'll see me on the side of the freeway giving, you know, handies and blowies for rent. We don't know, but we'll know in a couple years.
I have a futon if you're that desperate. I mean,
I'm gonna remember that. So let's get back. You know, let's meet up May 1st, 2019. Let's see what I'm doing. That's when my visa ends. So either I'll, you know, be on another visa, on a green card, or back in Canada, or in jail. Who knows? We don't know. But like, I have a stack of old vinyl, and you know, I found a bunch of comedy albums, and I still haven't listened to them because I found, and this is one of the reasons why I ended up selling my brand new decent, not a super nice one, but a decent record player. I bought it a few years ago. I got like the big speakers and everything, and I never listened to it.
I have a
Bluetooth speaker that I just hook up to my phone, and I Spotify comedy albums. Like, I listen to a lot of comedy albums, like John Mulaney and Louis C.K. I mean, pretty standard listening, but I really enjoy listening to those albums as well. But I never listen to that stuff on vinyl, because when I'm cleaning my house or doing my taxes or doing adult things or cooking, I'm listening to podcasts, I'm listening to comedy, I'm listening to talk radio on my Bluetooth speaker. Not, you know, having to walk over and plug in my phone or, like, put a comedy album in, like, 20 minutes come back and flip it.
Sure.
All that stuff. We've changed the way we listen, I think, a lot. And,
yeah.
You know, vinyl has this resurgence with, like, hipster culture. But, you know, for the most part, I doubt most hipsters are listening to vinyl every day. They're probably listening to their Bluetooth speaker.
Yep. I mean, I'm finding it hard enough to do it myself. I mean, like I said, I'm 3 weeks behind on this comedy album a day thing.
Yeah.
So now it's throw the record on, record it, flip it, record it while I'm doing other shit. Maybe in 3 weeks I'll be back to like literally sitting down and listening to it every time.
But you're catching up on it in the car or something like that.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. It is actually fun and is like kind of meditative.
Yeah.
Unless like 75% of these, it's shit.
Right.
Because I'll get a local act. I'll get something that is so dated that it's just unlistenable. You know?
Yep. Yep.
That happens.
But that's the great thing about comedy is that it can be just as fun to see shitty stand-up as fantastic stand-up. That weird Schadenfreude kind of way where you're just like, ooh, you're bombing. And I'm watching you shut down behind your eyes. Oh, this is so painful. But I'm kind of enjoying this. And I'm so sorry. It's a bit cruel. But, man, this is amazing. You know, that can be a wonderful element because that's entertainment on a different level.
Yeah.
It's a different type of entertainment. But I kind of enjoy that sometimes.
Yeah.
And every stand-up has to bomb 1,000 times before they, you know, Malcolm Gladwell it into the 10,000 hours that makes them, you know, a pro at something.
Yeah.
And I think any good stand-up or any stand-up that lasts knows that. And I've only done stand-up twice in my life. I took a Second City course in stand-up in Toronto and did a 5-minute set as our, like, graduation piece.
Okay.
And I love that, but it's kind of a loaded room because you invite friends and family to come out and see your set. And then I hosted a comedy night and, you know, had to do about 15 minutes of material over the course of the night between each person. And that was fun. I really loved doing that because, you know, you flip into crowd work. You do a little bit of improv and, you know, you write bits, but you got to learn how to sort of be a little bit malleable with it. It's something that I would like to explore more.
I was going to ask, actually. I was curious.
Here's the thing. I think most actors think they can just get up and do stand-up.
Sure.
And there's nothing worse than fucking watching that as an audience member. And you see that a lot in L.A. These small rooms where you know, people get up and you're like, oh, fuck, this is an actor and he's playing a role.
Yep.
The role of stand-up comedian. And he or she is doing a terrible job of it, but he or she thinks they're doing it so well. And they're emulating their favorites.
Sure.
And, you know, they're emulating their rhythm. They're emulating their style. They're writing their own jokes. But they don't have the discipline. The discipline of writing for stand-up, I guarantee you, all of these successful albumed stand-up artists, that they are disciplined writers. That they craft almost every word, or at least at one point craft every word in their set, in each bit, time it, make sure it's of the right time when they add the next bit and the next bit. Because if you go over in a comedy club in this town, and they're flashing the light at you, and you're like, you know, you put up your finger and you keep going for a couple more minutes, you're not going to get called back again. I mean, it's really ruthless, and it's regimented, almost like the military in this town, that, you know, if you got a tight five, you get up and you do a tight five.
Yeah.
We'll give you tight five in 30 seconds if you need it. if you're killing, but if you're doing balls, like, get off the stage. Right. So, you know, it's a discipline, and it's a lonely one at that. And those who are good at it are the ones that find their own voice, who really craft the writing, don't rely on their charm too much. I mean, that's very important. Mm-hmm. Charisma and charm, super important, but, like, don't fall back on it. Fall back on the discipline of your writing and your ability to edit the shit out of your writing.
I think you actually hear that on this album too.
Yeah.
Like, there are a couple times where he fucks up.
Yeah, he does.
But he fucks up a clearly written line. You know what I mean? It's not like he's just like, nope, just gonna power through it. He doesn't even try and change it.
He'll say, you know, because the goddamn hippies realize actually the children of hippies, and then he'll like boom 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 and go into and like he doesn't let it phase himself or phase him and get him out of his head. He's got great focus in this.
Mm-hmm.
Like I said, he's working on a level where he's got, you know, so many, he's got attention spans on so many different aspects of the room, and it's brilliant to watch people who can really do that.
Yeah.
But yeah, you see a lot of actors getting up, and I'm wary of that myself, because I don't, if I get up and do stand-up, I want to, I want to bomb a bunch so that I can really feel that, because it's terrible.
Yeah.
And I'm sure I will. It's funny, my manager just recently asked me, he's like, you know what, put a tight five together, just work a couple rooms and just have that in your back pocket. I'm like, you know what, that's not a bad idea. I don't have the, pardon me as I burp into the microphone, like mid-sentence, real classy. I don't have, actually I do have the time right now because I'm unemployed, but, generally, like, my roommate, I have a roommate here because I, you know, it's important, I think, when you move to a new city to not be as lonely as possible.
Yep.
My roommate is a stand-up, Aisha Alpha, and she's brilliant. I saw her for the first time recently. She, you know, she's an actress as well, and she's a very good actress. We met doing a show in Canada last summer called The Beaverton. But she does stand-up here in the city, and she's doing it two or three times a night. Like, she's getting out there, and she's working the scene. And she's doing bigger and bigger rooms now, and she's getting out there. She's smart about it. I mean, she's disciplined, and her writing's really tight. And when you see her in a room, in a smaller room with other people, she outshines everybody because she's got the discipline down. She's not an actress doing stand-up. She's doing her own thing, and she's great at it, and she's crafted her bits. And, you know, she's never referring to her notes. That always drives me crazy as a theater actor. And a live person, you know, with improv, that's a different story, but it always drives me nuts when people come up with like a pad and they're like kind of lazily like, oh, so what do we have next? Let's do that. Yeah. So here's the thing. What's up with dogs having sex with cats? Like, it drives me nuts. Like, I'm always way more impressed when I see someone come up with no notes and just slay. Just do their thing.
Sure.
And if they get off track, that doesn't bother me as long as they get back on track. They find a way
to
do it. Because I've been on stage doing a play and I've blanked before. I've gone up. And it's the scariest fucking feeling in the world.
I bet.
It is the stuff that nightmares and my nightmares are made of.
Yeah.
and you just breathe and it comes back to you. Because if you're disciplined and rehearsed, it'll come back to you.
Yeah.
You just breathe. You get oxygen into your brain, breathe deep. It'll come back to you if you're well prepared. And there's a lot of people out there who don't have the discipline. They're just like, I was a funny guy in high school. I made everybody laugh. And they said, come on out, get out to LA, do your thing. You're funny. And they come out and they make fart jokes on stage and they don't do well. Actually, I love fart jokes, but you know, it's a disciplined craft. I hate using that. Oh fuck. I hate saying that acting is a craft and comedy is a craft, but it does take discipline.
I would prefer hearing craft and skill to the word talent. If I never hear the word talent again,
I hate that word.
Yeah, me too.
I hate being on set and they're like, okay, can we get the talent over here? Talent, would you like to come with me? I'm like, I have a name.
Mm-hmm.
Just learn my name. I know maybe I'm only in for a couple days, but like, you have a call sheet in your hand.
Yeah.
Don't call me talent. Don't call me the talent.
It implies that it's God-given, that you were born with the ability to act, and you never tried.
I am not that. There is that. There are those few savants in our industry who just get it. They just have it. And I think, you know, there are famous examples of people like that out there. I'm not going to go through names because I'm sure it's controversial for some people. I don't know. Who cares? But there's people who just have it.
Mm-hmm.
They don't have to practice too hard. And I say, fuck you to those people. Sure, I hate it when I see that because I'm so jealous because I do not have that. I don't think I'm naturally talented. I think I got to work pretty hard to get to where I am, and I have worked for years to get to where I am. Discipline is the biggest thing I need to work on, and I went to military school, and I learned what discipline is, but self-discipline, man, my mother was drilling that into me when I was a kid. I literally had cue cards on my wall with definitions like self-discipline, the art of blah, 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 like, you know.
Holy
just
shit.
Oh, yeah, she was, like, big into motivating me to be self-disciplined, and I owe a ton to her as well for this business. But it's the most important thing in this business, and there are a lot of people who come to the city with zero discipline who just think they're going to coast through on their charm and charisma, and it's like, good luck, buddy.
Mm-hmm.
You're going to be on the freeway in 2 years giving handies and blowies, and I'm buying.
All right, let's talk. Let's do the what I like to do when we wrap up is, what's a good reason to recommend this album? Let's say either in two situations. One is a person doesn't know who Patton Oswalt is, somehow has never heard of him, or they only know him from current Patton Oswalt. What's a good reason to listen to this album?
This and a couple of albums, you're getting Patton before he's married and with a kid, before he's a family man, and that changes everybody.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it changed him. And I certainly, after he lost his wife, which was heartbreaking, you know, that will obviously change him. It'll be interesting to see, you know, Patton going forward from there. This is a younger Patton Oswalt. This is, you know, a 2004 interesting dude at the top of his game, I think, or just coming into it, really, because he really takes off at around this time.
Mm-hmm.
You're seeing someone who's really, like, worked it out in, like, the shitty tiny rooms, worked up to having his own TV specials, and being of that generation of David Cross and all the brilliance of and Louis C.K. coming up, like, this is just before Louis C.K. hit, really. Mm-hmm. And like I mentioned before, I think in terms of the science of stand-up comedy, it's a great, you know, stand-up 101 example.
Mm-hmm.
Of disciplined writing, moving past your mistakes without letting it throw you, crowd work, improv, how to throw that into a set, how to work it into your next bit. There's brilliant elements there. And it's also, you know, just like a lot of comedy from 10 years ago, 13 years ago in this case, it's like, this is what our culture talked like back then.
Mm-hmm.
Doesn't talk like this anymore.
It's true, yeah.
We shouldn't be throwing around the word gay so much. We shouldn't be saying retard. But it's a snapshot of 2004, of post 9/11 America.
Mm-hmm.
And, it's still very smart. We didn't even talk about Toronto open mic.
Oh yeah. Right. I know.
My hometown.
I know. Damn it.
But it's a really, it's a snapshot in time that I still love. It might not last the test of time as well as some of his more recent stuff, but I think it'll certainly do better than other comedy from that era.
It's also valuable as a, if you want to watch the arc of any comedian, or listen to, in this case, the arc of any, it's always valuable to know where they came from.
Yes.
And again, this is not the very beginning, but this is a very good, again, it's a good snapshot, but it's always good to know these different parts. It doesn't hurt to know more information, even if that information offends you. You know?
Totally.
It's fine. There's nothing wrong with taking more. I should point out, too, on the vinyl release, which is definitely worth getting, there are some inserts of the cutouts of little people and things. This is just like this most, the cutouts that are on the front, there are several of them on the inside of the record that you could actually, if you felt like it, chop up and turn into little display toys.
That is absolutely amazing. It's a gorgeous vinyl album. I love the cutout of the Black Angus bit on the front, because there's a Black Angus right over here where you are.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember driving past that the other day and just being like, it took me right back to this album. Before we ever got into this conversation of listening to this album, I was like, I've never seen a Black Angus before. It was like I was fresh into L.A. I was like, oh my God, it's a Black Angus.
Perfect.
And then I started going into the bit for my friends, and I was doing terrible at it. I'm like, you guys need to listen to this album. If you've never, and they hadn't listened to Patton Oswalt before, and I was like, listen to this bit because my shitty version of it was like making them laugh. And I'm like, well, you got to hear the real thing. It's incredible.
Well, I mean, the gravy pipeline is probably the most quoted. That whole thing is probably the most quoted bit on this entire album.
Totally.
Well, thank you so much for doing this.
Thank you for having
number
me.
Number one.
I don't think I've ever talked about comedy and comedic influences this long with anybody before. This was lovely.
Well, I'm honored.
Thank you.
And you're welcome back. You know, anytime.
I would love to. Yeah.
Again, if this should come out before Orphan Black premieres, I'm happy to do it. So let's say it does, and I'll write that down. What else do you want to promote? Where can people find you? Where can people find Orphan Black?
They can find me on Twitter at TheBrun, TheBrun, and on Instagram at Bonnie Castle, BonnyCastle, or just like going to the search bar and put in Christian Brun, you'll find me. Yeah, so Orphan Black, the fifth and final season, comes out on BBC America in the United States and BBC Worldwide, I guess, Space Channel in Canada on June 10th, and that is the fifth and final season. You can watch the previous seasons on Amazon, on Amazon Prime, and I highly suggest that you do if you've never seen it before. Other stuff I'm on, you can catch me popping up in weird random places in like 11/22/63 and, The Handmaid's Tale on Hulu. I've got a really creepy scene in that, which is fun. And some films that are out there. I don't know, just IMDb me and look me up.
Awesome.
Yeah.
I've never been more pissed that I don't have BBC America. I'm so angry. I have time to read.
There are ways. There are ways.
Yeah, but you know. You know, I don't feel right.
Yeah.
You know, you're in the room. I'll talk about that later. You know, I'll lie to myself. Well, I guess the only thing to promote for me is a comedy album a day. Go to youtube.com/comedyonvinyl, where you will see all of the comedy albums I've been listening to and reviewing and talking about. And then my movie comes out sometime this year, later this year, maybe. Just go to lookingforwardmovie.com and hopefully it'll be out at some point. Maybe by the time this comes. No, that won't happen. That will not happen. That will absolutely. That's bullshit. Well, that's about it. Again, thank you for being here.
Thank you so much for having me.
Thank you guys for listening. And as always, have a good thing. Comedy on Vinyl is a production of Stolen Dress Entertainment. It is produced by Mike Warden and is hosted and edited by Jason Klom. Our theme song was composed and performed by Richard Levinson. Please visit StolenDress.com to listen to our other podcasts, read our blogs, read our tweets, watch our videos, and read our books. Please subscribe on iTunes, and if you like us, give us a 5-star rating and a nice review. You can find us on Facebook.com/ComedyOnVinyl, Twitter at ComedyOnVinyl, and find everything else at ComedyOnVinyl.com. A major portion of Comedy on Vinyl has been underwritten by Stand Up Records. Please visit StandUpRecords.com for all your comedy needs and tune into the new Stand Up channel available on the Roku, where you can also find select episodes of this podcast.